First of all, I will revise the surface anatomy of pleura. Okay, see here, this is right side and this is left side. Okay, you have to see my cursor. Okay, now we will draw some points, or we will mark some points. Okay, and then afterward we will join those points with line to mark the pleura on the surface. Number one point is at the apex, which is about 1 inch above the medial 1/3 of the clavicle. Here they have not shown the clavicle, but you can imagine that here there will be clavicle. So the first point will be about 1 inch above the medial 1/3 of the clavicle. Then we will descend behind the sternoclavicular joint. This point B is sternoclavicular joint. Then we will reach the sternal angle. This is angle of Lewis, C point, angle of Lewis. Then we will descend down to the fourth costal cartilage. This is fourth costal cartilage. If you can count the ribs, this is one, this is two, then three, and then four. So we will reach the fourth costal cartilage. The right pleura will continue till the sixth costal cartilage. See here, this is the fifth point which we have drawn at sixth costal cartilage. This is sixth costal cartilage. But on the left side, from the fourth costal cartilage, we will not go down as such. Okay, because we have to make a cardiac notch of pleura. Okay, so the left pleura arches outward and descend lateral to the sternal border. See here, the sternal border. So it will go lateral to the sternal border and marking the cardiac notch till it reaches the sixth costal cartilage, the same level. Here on the right side, there was a straight line. On the left side, there is convexity outward. Okay, so we will reach the sixth costal cartilage. Now this was the apex and this was the anterior border of the right pleura, and this was the apex and the anterior border of the left pleura. Now we have to draw the inferior border. See here, this is inferior border. Okay, this is also inferior border. Okay, from here, from the sixth costal cartilage, we will go laterally, okay, around the chest, and we will draw a line up till the eighth rib in the midclavicular line. Can you see this line A? This is the level of the midclavicular line. Okay, so we will reach the eighth rib. This is eighth rib. We will reach here and we will draw a line from sixth costal cartilage to the eighth rib in the midclavicular line. Then from the eighth rib, we will go laterally and we will reach the 10th rib in the mid-axillary line. This B1 is mid-axillary line. So we will reach here at 10th rib in the mid-axillary line. Then we will go down and laterally and we will reach the 12th rib first. Okay, 12th rib in the line, 12th rib, this actually, this is the line to, we will reach the 12th rib and then we will go back. Okay, for imagine that you are going back. Okay, so this was 8th rib, then 10th rib, then this is 12th rib. So we will go back and we will draw a straight line at the back, okay, up till the 12th rib, and you will reach the 12th thoracic vertebra. But you have to stop 1 inch lateral to the 12th thoracic vertebra. For example, I will make here one line for you. See here, from the 12th rib, I am drawing one line, okay, and I will reach here. Okay, so this is one line. Again, see here, this is the line which I am drawing. I will reach here and stop 1 inch lateral to the 12th thoracic vertebra. This whole is inferior border. Which is inferior border? See here. This one is inferior border. This whole is inferior border. Okay. This is inferior border. Now what we will do, we have drawn the apex, we have drawn the anterior border, we have drawn the inferior border. Now we have to draw the posterior border. Remember one thing, the level of the posterior border of pleura, it will be from C7 till T12. See here, I am drawing one line going upward like this. Okay, this is the level C7, and below there will be level T12. So this will be a straight line which I am drawing. Okay, you can go from above to below or from below to above. You have to join a line which is from C7 till T12 in pleura. This line will be much smaller and it will be from C7 till T10 in lungs. Okay, in T10 in lungs, because you see here, because this red lining is the pleura marking and blue is the lung marking. See here, lung is inside the pleura, so it will be shorter. Okay, it will be much higher. See here, it is much higher. The important point which I was telling you, that because we have drawn the line of the inferior border at 8th rib in the mid axillary line, in the midclavicular line, the 10th rib at the mid axillary line, and 12th rib which will go behind, and it will be 1 inch lateral to the vertebral column. So this line will be for pleura, but when we have to draw a line for lung, we will go 6th rib. We will draw a line from 6th rib in the midclavicular line, then 8th rib in the mid axillary line, and 10th rib in the line which will be going posteriorly and which will be lateral to the vertebral column. So the lung will be higher and the pleura is lower. Okay, have you understood the inferior border? These three points are very, very important. And how we draw the posterior border? Posterior border will be from C7 till T12 in pleura, and C7 and T10 in lung. Okay, so this was the revision for the surface anatomy of the pleura. Again, you can see here the posterior border of the pleura. The pleura extends just below the 12th rib posteriorly. This is 12th rib and it will extend below the 12th rib. This is very, very important when we have to approach the kidney surgically from behind. Okay, see the lower border of the pleura, and this is the posterior border of the pleura. Again, the same slide, but it is for your revision. Here it is written that posterior margin is along the vertebral column from the apex C7 to inferior margin T12 spine. These three points are very, very important. I am again and again telling you that these points are important. 8th rib, 10th rib and 12th rib for pleura, and 6th rib and 8th rib and 10th rib for lung. These are three levels. One is midclavicular line, then mid axillary line, and the third level is adjacent to the vertebral column. Okay, on the left side, this is also very, very important, that from 4th to 6th costal cartilage, we have to draw a cardiac notch. See here the cardiac notch. Okay, this is the cardiac notch of the pleura and this is the cardiac notch of the lung, which is more sharp. For the lung, it is more sharp. This area is called as area of cardiac dullness. Area of dullness. Okay, this is the area of dullness. Why area of dullness? Because on percussion, we will not hear any breath sounds here, because here there is no lung. Okay, this is cardiac dullness. Here there is heart. Okay, no lung is present here. So on percussion, we cannot hear breathing sounds here. Now, there will be many revisions also. See here, the cervical dome of the pleura and the apex of lungs, they extend up into the neck so that at their highest point, they lie about 1 inch above the clavicle. They are vulnerable to stab wounds in the root of the neck or to the damage by the anesthetist needle during nerve block of the lower trunk of the brachial plexus. See here, if there is any stab wound here in the neck, okay, or if anesthetist is blocking the lower trunk of the brachial plexus, so the needle can puncture this part of pleura. This is cervical pleura, okay, cervical pleura. Now, the lower limit of the pleural reflection, which we can see from the back also, they may be damaged during nephrectomy. See here, I will show you the part which is posteriorly. See this part. This part can be damaged while doing any operation for the kidney or removing the kidney, which is called as nephrectomy. Now, again, pleura, the paired pleura and lungs lie on either side. See here, the paired pleura and lungs, they are on either side of the mediastinum. What is mediastinum? Mediastinum is the area in the middle of the chest cavity where heart and great vessels are present. Each pleura has two layers. See my highlighter? Each pleura consists of two layers. The outer one is called as the parietal layer and the inner one is called as the visceral layer. The parietal layer lines the thoracic wall and it covers the thoracic surface of the diaphragm and lateral aspect of the mediastinum. See here, it is covering the lateral aspect of the mediastinum because mediastinum is in the middle and this is the lateral aspect of the mediastinum. And it will extend into the root of the neck to line the under surface of the suprapleural membrane at the thoracic outlet. The visceral layer, this was about the parietal layer. Okay, again I will repeat, parietal layer will form a cervical part which is in the neck, okay, which is lining the under surface of the suprapleural membrane. Number two, the costal part which is at the under surface of the ribs. Okay, in all thoracic wall, then the diaphragmatic part, see here, the diaphragmatic part, it is lining the upper surface of the diaphragm. Then there is mediastinal part which is covering the lateral part of the mediastinum. This was about parietal pleura. Now see here the visceral pleura in blue color. Can you see visceral pleura? Visceral pleura completely covers the outer surface of the lungs. Okay, and it extends into the depth of the interlobar fissures. See here, when we will read the lung, I will show you fissures. There are many fissures in the lung. So what will happen? The visceral pleura will go inside the fissure. It will go inside the depth of the interlobar fissure. Okay, it is very thin from the parietal layer. See in this diagram also, this is cervical pleura, this is costal pleura, this is diaphragmatic pleura and this is mediastinal pleura. These divisions are very, very important. Now, I will show you another diagram. This is the cross-section of the thorax at the level of 8th thoracic vertebra. Okay, this is T8. Can you see lungs here? Okay, these are the lungs. This is right lung and this is left lung and this is heart. Okay, and this is sternum. This is the anterior view and this is the vertebral side is the posterior view. Okay, you can see pleura here. This is parietal pleura and this is visceral pleura in the blue color. Can you see the visceral pleura is going inside the fissure also? It is going inside the fissure also. Same here, the visceral pleura is going inside the fissure also. Okay, these are the layers which are covering or which are bounding the lung. They are pleura. Same layers which are present around the heart, these layers are called as pericardium. These are called as pericardium. Just like pleura for the heart, for the lungs, the pericardium is for the heart. Okay. Now see in this diagram, they have shown the sternum. These are ribs and costal cartilages. Okay, these are lungs. This is right lung and this is left lung. Okay, and they have shown, they have cut from here. This was anterior part and that one is the posterior part which they have shown the vertebral column. Okay, in the middle, this part is called as mediastinum and the pleura which is on the side of mediastinum, this is called as mediastinal pleura. Can you see the two layers of the pleura? The outer one is called as the parietal layer and the inner one is called as the visceral layer, and in between the two layers, this cavity or this space is called as pleural cavity or pleural space. See here, two names, pleural cavity and pleural space. Actually, when we talk about cavity, we think that it is a big cavity, just like the thoracic cavity. Okay, so we might have confused with the pleural cavity and the thoracic cavity. See here, this pleural cavity is very, very small. It is a slit-like space. That's why for this cavity, the anatomists, they have given the name pleural space so that we should not mix the pleural cavity with the thoracic cavity. Okay, this is very, very important because thoracic cavity means the whole chest wall cavity in which the lungs and the pleura and the heart and all other great vessels are present. That is the thoracic cavity. But the pleural cavity is a small space. It is a slit-like space which is in between the two layers of the pleura. That is the parietal pleura and the visceral pleura. Okay, this is a very small space. Now see here, this is costal pleura. Why this is called as costal? Because it is on the undersurface of the ribs. It is on the inside part of the ribs. This is costal pleura. Then there will be diaphragmatic pleura here. See, I have revised these divisions of pleura many times. These are the divisions for the parietal pleura. Okay, number one is cervical, number two is costal, number three is diaphragmatic, number four is mediastinal. Okay, now see here, they have shown the medial surfaces of the lungs. Okay, again I will show you all the divisions of the pleura. See, these are the ribs. Can you see the ribs here? Okay, these are the ribs. Okay, this is the medial surface. On the medial surface, there is a small region which is called as the hilum of the lung. Hilum of lung is a region from which the vessels, they are either exiting or entering the lung. Okay, can you see a small ligament which is hanging down from the hilum? This ligament is called as pulmonary ligament. Okay, pulmonary ligament. See here in this diagram also, this is the hilum of the lung. Okay, and veins are coming out, arteries are going inside, and this is the pulmonary ligament for the lung. Okay, so the two layers, they are continuous with one another via cuff of pleura that surround the structures entering or leaving the lung at the hilum of each lung. Okay, this cuff hangs down as a pulmonary ligament, and this pulmonary ligament is an empty space, and it is allowing the movement of the pulmonary vessels and large bronchi during respiration. See again, this is the region which is called as hilum of the lung. Here the structures, the artery, the vein and bronchi, they are very closely placed. Okay, but they have to expand during inspiration. And so what will happen? There will be a space. Can you see a space here? This space is called as pulmonary ligament. This space will provide all these vessels and bronchi to expand during respiration. Okay, so this is pulmonary ligament. Again, this is a diagram which is taken at the level of T1, okay, or at the level of the suprapleural membrane. See the cervical dome of the pleura. They have shown the apex of the lung, which is covered by the cervical dome of pleura. This is first rib, okay, this is manubrium sternae. First rib, okay, this is first rib, this is another first rib on the other side. This is T1, which is first thoracic vertebra. This is manubrium sternae. This is the cervical dome of pleura. That is, if we see from above, so these are the structures which are present. This is the thymus, which is a gland, okay, thymus. Then these are infrahyoid muscles. There will be many arteries which you can see from here. Okay, this is brachiocephalic artery. This is the nerve, which is vagus nerve on the right side. This is right vagus. Then there will be left vagus nerve on the left side, right phrenic nerve on the right side, left phrenic on the left side. Okay, here there is right brachiocephalic trunk, but on the left side we have two arteries, that is left common carotid artery and left subclavian artery. Vein, this will be the superior vena cava on the right side, okay, and on the left side this is internal jugular vein, the left internal jugular vein. Okay, so these are the structures which are visible here. Okay, this is trachea, which is anterior, and esophagus, which is posterior. So this is the level at the cervical dome of pleura. This is cervical dome of pleura, which is covering the cervical part of the lung. Now this is another diaphragm. Okay, I will tell you one most important point. Okay, sometimes in Dr. Amna's lecture you have heard and you have learned the thoracic apertures. There is thoracic inlet and outlet. Do you remember? Okay, but remember one thing, these thoracic inlet and the word thoracic outlet, they are different in different books. For example, these diagrams I have taken from Snell's, okay? So they have told that this level is called as, which is the cervical dome of pleura and suprapleural membrane, this is called as thoracic inlet, okay? But in KLM, it is written that this is called as thoracic outlet, okay? So different authors have written different things, okay? So do not mix. If you are writing the above aperture as thoracic inlet, so you can write the reference of Snell's. But if you are writing the above aperture as thoracic outlet, so you can write the reference of KLM. Okay, so do not mix these things or do not confuse with these things. Okay. Now, this is another level. This is T4 level. This is T4 vertebra. This is manubrium sternae. Again, this is thymus. Okay. This is right lung. Right lung, and this is left lung. Okay. They are lined by two pleura. This is parietal pleura, and visceral pleura is just attached to the lung. Okay. On the right side, we have superior vena cava. We have right phrenic nerve. There will be right vagus nerve. And this is azygous vein, which is draining in the superior vena cava. This is trachea. This is esophagus. On the left side, we have arch of aorta, the biggest vessel of our body, the biggest artery of our body. Okay. Then this is left phrenic nerve and the left vagus nerve on the left side. So this is the level of the cross section of the thorax at the fourth thoracic vertebra. Okay, the parietal and the visceral layers of the pleura, they are, I have already told you, they are separated from one another by a slit-like space, the pleural cavity or the pleural space. The pleural cavity normally consists of only a small amount of tissue fluid, which is called as pleural fluid. Can you see here in this diagram, the outer one is the red colored, this is parietal pleura, and the inner one, this is visceral pleura, and in between the two, there is a pleural space. Okay, here there is pleural fluid. Pleural fluid covers the surfaces of the pleura as a thin film, which causes the surface tension adhesion of the pleural layers and permit them to move on one another. This fluid will permit the two layers to move on one another with minimal friction. Thus, the pleural cavity is a potential space, okay, under normal conditions. But this space can be shown, or this space can be enlarged or discernible only under abnormal conditions, okay? Only under abnormal conditions when the lung is displaced by the air or the excess fluid. So see here again, the outer layer is called as the parietal layer and the inner one is called as the visceral layer. In between the two layers, this is the pleural space. Okay, this will be a slit-like space, but this space can be enlarged in different conditions. Okay, when there is pleural effusion or there is pneumothorax or many other abnormal conditions, which I will tell you afterwards. Okay, for the purpose of description, again see, in the Snell's, they have repeated the cervical pleura, mediastinal, diaphragmatic, and the costal pleura many times. Again, they are describing that parietal pleura is divided according to the region in which it lies or on the surface that it covers. The cervical pleura, it is also called as cupula. It extends up into the neck, lining the undersurface of the suprapleural membrane. It reaches at a level of 1 to 1.5 inch, which is about 2.5 centimeters above the medial third of the clavicle. We have revised this thing many times. Again, the cervical, this was cervical pleura, and now we will discuss the costal pleura. See in this diagram, costal pleura is lining the inner surface of the ribs, the costal cartilages, the intercostal spaces, that the sides of the vertebral bodies and the back of the sternum. See here. So this is costal pleura. Costal pleura. The diaphragmatic pleura, it covers the thoracic surface of the diaphragm. See here, there will be diaphragm. So it is covering the thoracic surface of the diaphragm. What will happen actually? I want to tell you two recesses. Recess is a space which is present in the thorax. So there are two recesses in the thorax. One is called as osteodiaphragmatic recess. And one is called as osteomediastinal recess. From the name, it is obvious that osteodiaphragmatic recess, it is in between the costal pleura and diaphragmatic pleura. This is a space. Can you see a space here below the lung? This is osteodiaphragmatic space. And there will be a small space, okay, in between the costal pleura and mediastinal pleura also. Okay, so what will happen actually? In quiet respiration, the costal and the diaphragmatic pleura, they are in opposition to one another below the lower border of the lung. Okay, in quiet respiration, they will be in opposition with one another. But in deep inspiration, the margins of the base of the lung, they will descend down, they will go down. And the costal pleura and the diaphragmatic pleura, they will separate. This lower area of the pleural cavity into which the lung expand on inspiration. This is a space in which the lung will expand and will come down during inspiration. This area is called as costo-diaphragmatic recess. Okay, see here in this diagram. This is a very good diagram. See the outer layer. This is outer layer, which is parietal pleura. This is inner layer, which is visceral pleura. Okay, this is pleural space. And this will be, this area will be costo-diaphragmatic recess. See here, costo-diaphragmatic recess. And this area will be costo-mediastinal recess. Okay, so the mediastinal pleura covers and form the lateral boundary of the sternum, of the mediastinum. This is mediastinum. See here, this is mediastinum. So it will cover the lateral surface of the mediastinum. It reflects a cuff. Can you see here? This is very important diagram. Here you can see that the parietal pleura and visceral pleura, they are continuous with one another here. Only at one point in all of the thoracic part. See here, this parietal pleura outer layer and visceral pleura inner layer, they are continuous with one another only at the hilum of the lung. Otherwise, the lungs, they are not attached to any structure anteriorly or posteriorly. Only they are attached to the hilum of the lung. Okay, so they are free all others at all other spaces, but they are fixed at the hilum of the lung. And here the parietal and the visceral pleura, they are continuous with one another. Okay, this is also called as the lung root. Hilum of the lung is also called as the lung root. Okay, so each lung lies free except at its hilum, where it is attached to the blood vessels and bronchi, and it constitute the lung root. During full inspiration, the lungs expand. They will expand and fill the pleural cavities. However, during quiet inspiration, the lungs do not fully occupy the pleural cavities at four sites. What are those four sites? Number one is the right costo-diaphragmatic recess. Number two is left costo-diaphragmatic recess. Number three is right costo-mediastinal recess. And number four is left costo-mediastinal recess. So these are four spaces which are not occupied by the lungs during quiet inspiration. So this is also very, very important. Okay, again they have described the costo-diaphragmatic recess. They are slit-like spaces between the costal pleura and the diaphragmatic pleura. See here, in this they have shown in the green color. They are separated only by a capillary layer of the pleural fluid. During inspiration, the lower margins of the lung descend in space. I have told many times that during inspiration, the lung will come down and it will fill this costo-diaphragmatic recess. But during expiration, the lower margin of the lung will go up, or it will ascend, so that the costal and the diaphragmatic pleura come together again. So this is also very, very important. Okay, see here in this diagram, the costo-mediastinal recess. They have putting the hand in the costo-mediastinal recess, and below they are putting the hand in the costo-diaphragmatic recess. In this diagram also, number one are costo-diaphragmatic recesses and number two is costo-mediastinal recess. Okay, the costo-mediastinal recess is present along the anterior margin of the pleura. They are also slit-like spaces between the costal pleura and the mediastinal pleura, and they are separated by the capillary layer of the pleural fluid. During inspiration and expiration, the anterior border of the lungs slide.